I'm Jim Henson, director of the Texas Politics Project at the University of Texas at Austin. We're here today to have a conversation about politics and policy, not necessarily in that order, with State Representative Donna Howard of Austin, who serves as co-chair of the House Calendars Committee, as well as a member of the Appropriations, Higher Ed, and Administration Committees. Among other things, Representative Howard holds 2 degrees from the University of Texas at Austin, so we're extra glad to have you here.
Thank you.
To UT.
Extra glad to be here.
Well, terrific. let's dive right into it. Allowing for the fact that the budget, of course, is the one thing that has to be done. You know, what's important, you think? What needs to get done this time other than the essential thing or the budget? Or what should the priorities be?
Well, I think the Speaker of the House, who's the leader of the body that I'm a part of, laid out some agenda items before session started, and I think we're pretty much focused on those things. It certainly does have to do with a responsible budget, but also has to do with making sure we're addressing the crisis of the foster care system, making sure that we're investing appropriately for small businesses and entrepreneurship, those kinds of things. You know, for me personally, I would like to see us do more in the realm of addressing the school finance dilemma that we're in, as well as more significant investment in higher education. We talk about wanting to have an educated workforce pipeline, and we slide back in terms of the monetary investment. I think that makes it very difficult to achieve those goals.
Well, let's start with public ed then, okay. Since you highlighted that and you've been active in that area. And that bill, HB 21, will be coming to the floor this week. Amendments were filed today. How well do you think that bill does at addressing the problems we need to address?
Well, I think it's a good first step for sure, considering the fact that we're not going to be, apparently, addressing overall school finance reform. Doing something is better than nothing. And in fact, you know, looking here at Austin ISD, that's a poster child for how dysfunctional the current finance system is when Austin actually sends the largest amount of recaptured dollars back to the state, almost $500 million of local property taxes. At the same time has about 60% of its kids on free and reduced lunch, which is our metric for being low income. It just doesn't make sense. And it's based on a formula that was developed decades ago that the weights, the cost of education index, none of those things have been updated. It does not reflect the current cost of delivering education. So I'm hopeful we'll do something. I'm hopeful about House Bill 21. It won't do everything we need, and it will only make a little bit of a step forward, but it is a step forward.
Before we came on the air, we were talking about kind of the arc of this in some ways. You said we should have done it last time. What do you think is different this time?
Well, I'll tell you what's different this time that makes it even more critical that we get on board, I think, is that last time was a bigger fix, and we actually had surplus dollars with which to work. We don't have those surplus dollars this time. This is a smaller step without the dollars. We weren't able to pass it when we actually had the dollars. I'm very concerned about letting this opportunity pass us by, and I don't want to see that happen. The schools need us to do some things now and not wait for another legislative session.
So it was one of the things that helped this time was that everybody had the excuse last time of waiting to see what the court was going to say.
Right.
And the court actually put the legislature in kind of an awkward position in the sense of telling you should do it, but not making you.
Exactly. And that was a different outcome for the other courts. Rulings. But, you know, the fact is that everybody talks about it. Republicans, Democrats, everybody at the legislature thinks that we need to fix school finance. It's not anything that's not shared by all. But obviously the devil's in the details and how you make that happen. And the way I like to think about it is that, you know, you have a pie that pays for public education. And if you keep the pie the same size and you just divvy up the slices differently, there's winners and losers. Can't pass that. You really need to have a bigger pie so that when you make different slices, you're hopefully not getting any losers. Some people aren't going to gain as much as others. And that's kind of what we were seeing last session and kind of what we're seeing this session as well. Most school districts will see some gains.
And that's a good sign in terms of gains translating into votes, it looks like.
Well, I think so, yeah.
One would hope.
I hope.
also in public ed, what do you make of this? You know, what I think of is the strange case of pre-K.
Yeah.
How do you explain that to the public? And that, you know, there's all this jockeying around pre-K. It seems to be a good idea. The governor's behind it.
Right.
Neither chamber seems to want to do it. Is this a policy difference?
I think it's a mix of policy and politics, which a lot of things are, of course. You know, last session, my office and others worked really hard on trying to get more funding in for quality pre-K. We know from the studies that have been done what works. And it's very difficult to achieve the things that work with only paying for a half day, which is what the state currently does. A lot of districts recognize that full day is very important. And in fact, like here in Austin, they use other funds. They find other funds with which to have an actual full day of pre-K. San Antonio actually taxes themselves, and part of their sales tax goes to a full day pre-K. We were pushing to have more funding and to have a set of criteria that need to be met. Certainly the governor was on board, but he was on board for a lesser amount. And what finally passed was that lesser amount, which certainly benefited some school districts, but was not enough to go around and make a huge amount of difference. So the political part, of course, is when he came back for the state of the state and basically wagged his finger at the legislature and said, you know, either fully fund this or don't do it at all. And I think the sentiment was, okay, let's look at how we might do it differently, knowing that what we had set up last time was not, did not have the significant impact that we had wanted it to have. So this time, the House is putting in the amount of money that the governor was requesting, but rather than having it in his grant program, we've created another, what's being called an enhancement supplement, that will go to all pre-K classes throughout the state, not just to those that would apply for a grant, which is what the previous program did. So it's still being funded in a different way with the hopes that at some point we'll recognize the need to invest what's going to be probably another $1 billion at least to get us all up to a full day pre-K.
And as you say, this is a tough time to find $1 billion.
It sure is.
Or even a half a million.
It is.
Let's move on to higher ed a little bit then, since you're on the higher ed committee. Seems to me we're reaching another kind of critical mass point on Hazelwood, Veterans for Benefits. How do you expect, you know, where are you on that and how do you expect it to shake out?
Well, we're hearing several approaches, from one that says, let's just take money out of the Economic Stabilization Fund and fully fund this and be done with it. To those that are wanting to tweak the eligibility, grandfather in the legacy part, which is for kids of veterans, grandfather those in that now qualify, but phase that part out, a lot of different things that are being looked at. I don't know that we have the answer at this point. I do think that politicians like to, beat our chests about supporting our veterans, and legislation that supports them is always really popular. I think this shows that sometimes we do that and then kind of back off once we see the dollar figures rising more than we thought. And in this case, I hate to see us go back on our promise to the veterans. That doesn't mean we can't change things along the way for the future, but I certainly wouldn't support anything that didn't grandfather in everybody who's currently a part of the system.
But it sounds to me like you recognize the fiscal difficulty of going forward with
absolutely.
The current system.
I think the current number I've seen is something like $200 million. And we have a set aside fund for Hazelwood that only has about $47 million in it. Yeah. This squarely falls on the back of the institutions, which means it falls on the backs of the students and their tuition to help pay for this. I don't think that's the way we should be doing it. I think the state has a responsibility to find the revenue and to pay for this.
So you mentioned tuition. How about tuition deregulation? Yeah, we're just going to go through a bunch of easy things.
Oh, yeah, really easy. Well, you know, back in the day when I came to UT, which I started here in 1969, before you were born.
And that's not true, but that's very nice of you.
Anyway, I think at that time, the portion of UT's budget that came from the state was somewhere between 60 and 80%. And now it's probably around about 12%. Before deregulation happened in 2003, the state was putting in less and less already and not being able to keep up. And the institutions needed more flexibility. And so we had deregulation, which of course shot tuition up. It's leveled off some. It keeps growing, but it did level off some. The fact is that over the past 10 years, I think the state share overall across the entire state has gone down from about, I think it was about 40% to 30%. And the share of tuition has gone up by the same 10%. Right. So it's, you know, I recognize the need for affordability. We're still a good deal, everybody tells us, when you look at other institutions in other states. But we've been shirking on our financial aid program. You know, once it was deregulated and tuition increased, we were supposed to be investing more in tuition assistance.
It was actually part of the deal initially.
Absolutely.
When it was passed.
Absolutely. And, you know, initially the Texas Grants, which is our premier program, was supposed to be funding average tuition and fees, and it was somewhere, I think, around $7,500 per eligible student. We now apportion that money at about $5,000 per eligible student, even though tuition and fees have gone up, so we can claim we're giving it to more eligible students.
Right.
So you just lower the amount, then you can increase the pool of people that are eligible to receive something. And we did, we have in this budget, we put more in at that $5,000 level. The House has proposed covering 95% eligibility. Last session, it was 85%. So, you know, we have a proposal that at least is going in the right direction, but it's a struggle. And I think we need to be looking at tuition assistance as one of the main remedies for what's going on with affordability.
Rather than going back on regulation or, you know, reinstituting
a
more centralized solution.
I'm not sure that we could count on the state to regulate it in a way that would give us what we want.
So how about then the top 10% rule?
You are really coming up with it, aren't you? You know, I think that it's been shown in the hearings that I've sat in on that the top 10% has had an impact in a lot of ways on attendance in public institutions in our state. It hasn't increased the diversity that was expected, I think. There's some. Part of that's just the growth in our population. What it's done is has impacted the geographic distribution. And also, I think, given some students more hope about getting into institutions, especially something an institution like the flagship University of Texas or Texas A&M, where once they might have thought, I can't aspire to that, now can have automatic admission. That's a very good thing for students that have the abilities but had maybe their first time college-going students in their family. The issue, of course, is that the University of Texas, it's approaching, if we didn't curb it, 100% of freshman admissions would be top 10%. And though that sounds good in theory, in practice, it means that the institution doesn't have any control over its student population in terms of the diversity it wants to have, not only ethnic and racial diversity, but also diversity in the different colleges, diversity in the different degree programs and degree plans. So, you know, we've had a situation where we've rolled that back to about 7.5%. Rather than 10%, giving some flexibility. And I think whatever the number is, we need to give some flexibility to the University of Texas. And so I would be supportive of some kind of rollback. I'm not necessarily interested in 100% rollback, though.
Would you be interested in looking at it again? To a certain degree, on this and deregulation, it is a matter, to some degree, I think of, and maybe I'm wrong, how much the legislature actually trusts the institutions.
Yeah. Well, yes. And we're seeing this session unfortunately, there's a lot of things that are happening that seem to be of that vein, and specifically with the University of Texas at Austin. So we're having some challenges this time.
Trust issues.
Trust issues, yes. Trust issues on a lot of things, like what to do with property that's been bequeathed to the University of Texas, and yet there's not a lot of trust among some that property will be able to be maintained as a green space in the center of Tarrytown. But
you're speaking so anonymously about that.
I am, aren't I? You know, this is the bottom line for me. The president of the University of Texas and the mayor of Austin are in good faith negotiations. And I think that's the proper process to work this out, not to have a senator from North Texas come in and lay out a bill that seizes that property and gives it to Texas Parks and Wildlife. That's not a precedent I want to see set.
That, among other things, seems to be there's a lot of talk in the air right now about asserting state authority in rather direct ways. Does that feel new to you?
Well, it's always been there to a certain extent, because being from Austin, I think there's been kind of this ongoing sense that of Austin bashing and
speaking of trust issues.
Yes, trusting local people to vote for their locally elected officials and letting them make the laws that work for the local people. Yeah, that kind of trust. So yes, we have more of it this time than we've had before. I think that escalated after the fracking in Denton situation. But certainly we have a lot of legislation this time that's trying to dictate to local jurisdictions what they can and cannot do.
Before we move off out of higher ed, I do want to ask you about what you think the legislature can or can't do in terms of response to the recent reports on sexual assault on campuses.
Yeah.
I know those broadly an area you've been engaged in before
right.
in other areas. You know, is there something the legislature can do about that?
You know, that's part of what we were struggling with over the interim. When we actually had a hearing, we had an interim charge on this issue and had a hearing, and it was hard to figure out what the legislature's role was in this. There has definitely been legislation proposed and passed in the Senate that we'll see coming over to the House that Senator Kirk Watson has, that I think is a good effort to try to make sure that we're doing all we can in requiring certain reporting. One part that has had some stalling, but we're still looking at is affirmative consent, and what does that look like? So I think there are some things we can do, but I think, again, you go back to trust. I think we're trusting the institutions to want to keep a safe campus for their students and doing what they can to make that happen. I know the University of Texas has done a lot to try to improve things. That doesn't mean we can't do better. And, you know, so the area that I've been focused on actually with sexual assault, I had a legislation that passed this last week in the House in terms of setting up a statewide web of tracking the rape kits and forensic evidence. That's been an issue, and that's been partly a contributing factor to the backlog. So I'm hopeful it's going to pass the Senate and that will be put into place. That's not directly related to campus, but it does still impact how things are dealt with on campus.
Well, I was going to ask you about that, Bill, so let's talk about it.
Okay.
I mean, how are its prospects in the Senate, do you think?
I think good. I actually have two leading senators that are interested in carrying the bill, and I'm very, very happy and hopeful because of that. you know, this is one of those things where we have, unfortunately, a large number of sexual assaults that are reported, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. One of the problems we have with this particular crime is that people are hesitant to report for a variety of reasons, but one of the reasons is because there's a sense that nothing's going to be done. And I think people are pretty aware of the backlog of the rape kits. And there's a sense of, why should I go through this traumatizing exam where it's going to take hours and it's invasive and not be assured that evidence is actually going to be used? This tracking is one of the ways to say we do respect what's happened here. We do want you to have justice. We are going to make sure this evidence is examined, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure that it goes through the process in an efficient and timely manner. And by the way, you'll have an access code so you can track it at any time you want to.
I think the reaction to this issue in some ways is to be appalled at this, that you have to sell this.
Yeah.
I mean, is that, I mean, I'm you know, asking you to manufacture outrage, right. But I mean, as you've talked to your colleagues about this, I mean, do you get a sense that that's a reaction, at least with some people?
Well, with some, but I would say with very few. And some of the reaction is fiscal. And the fact is, though, being on appropriations, one of the things we were able to do is, number one, put, I think Chairman Zerwas put about $4.2 million into addressing the backlog. And then I was able to work with Representative Capriglione, who was dealing with IT in the budget, and we got money put in to set up this statewide digital system through DPS. So, you know, I feel like their concerns maybe misplaced to a certain extent. You know, it was very few that were against it. There is a certain amount of selling, though, still. Why do we need this? Is it more government regulation? That kind of thing. Right. But in this case, I think most people get it.
Because fiscally, it's really, I mean, million here, a million there, et cetera. But still, it's not that much money, right?
In the greater scheme of things, no. And it can make a big difference in the delivery of justice.
Something that is a lot more money in was an interesting, and I think to some a little bit surprising move in the House budget, and you were on the appropriations, was the move on Medicaid policy.
Oh, yeah.
And the shift in money in Medicaid.
Yeah.
Talk to us a little bit about that. I mean, on one hand, I mean, I think you can make sense of that in terms of it's time to, we're going to have more bargaining room with the federal government.
Right.
Let's get the budget hit and, the budget benefits and use that as the rationale for the reduction in the funds allocated for Medicaid.
Right.
But it's a lot, right? I mean, what's...
It's a lot, but it's actually not any more than we typically do. When we fund only, in one year we funded only 20 months, I believe, of the 24
right.
months, and then came back and made it up. But oftentimes we underfund it. It's an estimate, and we estimate probably on the low side, traditionally, expecting that we're going to come back and pay our bills because it's an entitlement. We have to pay it. This time, I think the idea was that, yes, with the new administration in Washington, that there might be more room to negotiate some more of those federal funds coming to Texas that some of my colleagues have been averse to receiving with previous administration. So I think we could have had more explicit language about saying, if indeed we're able to draw down more of the Medicaid expansion dollars, then let's have some mechanism in there to allow that to happen. I think there was concern on the part of some that we don't want to talk about that too much, though. There's still too many knee-jerk reactions.
Still looks too much like Obamacare.
Exactly.
Basically.
But the fact is that, it's about $1 billion of GR, mm-hmm. state GR, and then another two point something or close to one and a half, I guess, of federal dollars. So overall, it's about $2.5 billion. That is money that we will make up and we will cover no matter what happens. I think there are some that are concerned because of what happened with the acute care therapy cuts that we had this last session, this would mean a cut in services, and that is not the intention. This is a common practice. It was worded, I think, a little differently this time, but it is not meant to be a cut.
Because the concern is, that you could gain the bargaining leverage and it could go in the direction you're suggesting, but what if it goes the other direction, right?
Absolutely. And I've been assured by Chairman Zerwas that the intention here is to make sure that we give the flexibility, but that we also know we're going to come back and make sure that everybody gets paid and that everybody gets the services. We actually put a rider in the budget that an amendment, I guess, that night that basically says that this has to be done without reducing benefits or eligibility.
You mentioned at the outset, I want to come back to the problems with foster care and CPS. Yeah. This is another area where I think people looked at this. It was a few areas of consensus, really, yeah. going into the session, that this was pretty appalling state of affairs. Right. How do you think, where do you think we are in sort of resolving that? Obviously, the legislature can't be held responsible for what's going on this instant, at least right. in terms of what you're doing now. But it is, you know, there's an AP story yesterday, I think, that there were twice as many kids either staying in offices or in temporary care situations right. in March than there were in February. I mean, do you think there's enough money plugged into that? Do you think that the kinds of solutions that the legislature seems to be looking at right now are on the right track?
I think we're moving in the right direction, but I don't think we're fully there. You know, this has been going on for years. The fact that the legislature finally woke up to saying that it's a crisis and an emergency and we need to do something, we've known about these things. It certainly is something that we shouldn't be turning a blind eye to, and especially when they become foster kids, they're our kids. They're the state's kids, our responsibility. I think we've gone a long way with the budget to fund the request that would help on the investigation end of this equation. We now need to focus more on the capacity, the foster care capacity end. Placement capacity. And again, we've got some legislation to address that. I'm not sure, but I would hypothesize that one of the reasons we're seeing more kids staying in state offices and that sort of thing is because we don't have the placement capacity, and we are doing a better job with the investigation in, and perhaps we're identifying the kids but then don't have the place to put them. I still believe we've underfunded the request and that we need to do more. I think it should be a high enough priority that we find the money wherever and make sure that we're covering what needs to be done so that we move this track, this going a totally different direction, and that we're always going to have the issue, but we need to make sure these kids are taken care of.
So as we've gone through a lot of these topics, the theme has been moving in the right direction, but we're not spending enough money. Okay, so that leads us to the question of where we find the money, and yeah. the, you know, inside baseball, but critical, really policy question of, do we use the economic stabilization fund, the rainy day fund, how much and on what basis? As we were talking before, is it fair to perceive, you think, that we have moved from don't use it, use it, to what's the argument for using it?
I think that's fair. You know, I want to preface this by saying that the reason we're having some struggle with funds this time is because of policy decisions made in the last legislative session, where it was decided to offer a $4 billion tax cut, which sounds good in the aggregate, but most Texans didn't even realize that. And then on top of that, made the decision, rather than to outright appropriate to transportation, to have a constitutional amendment that would skim off the top of our sales tax growth, which is our main source of revenue, up to $5 billion of growth to go be dedicated to transportation. Good thing transportation needed it, but it means whatever growth we had, which is close to $5 billion, is all going to transportation. Nothing can go to higher ed or public ed or healthcare or any other things that the state needs. So it's a manufactured situation, a self-imposed, but here we are. And I know that the House, of course, has looked at, in a bipartisan way, using the Economic Stabilization Fund to the tune of about $2.5 billion to fund some of the needs for next session. And the Senate, of course, hasn't done that, but I think there is more of a willingness to look among some, to look at so-called one-time expenditures, which, you know, that also sounds good. I think basically anybody who understands economics knows you cannot provide ongoing operational expenses with a savings account. That doesn't work. You run out of money. Right. So we all get that. But there are other reasons to use the Economic Stabilization Fund to, as it was originally intended, to manage some of the downturns, to smooth those over so that you're not having to significantly increase taxes or cut services. That's an appropriate use of it as well. And so, you know, we'll keep having those discussions, but I'm hopeful.
I want to talk a little bit about politics in the last few minutes, okay, since we've talked mostly nuts and bolts.
That's my thing.
You know, what are the prospects? I mean, let's just ask the question you must get all the time. You know, what are the prospects of the Democrats going forward? I mean, it's interesting to talk to you. And, you know, you've obviously found a way to be very active, to serve your constituents, to get things done in the legislature by accepting some of the limitations that kind of shot through a lot of your answers. Mm-hmm. You know, as you look forward, do you see the fundamentals changing at all in terms of partisan balance, in terms of what that looks like?
You know, it's interesting. I kind of feel like the pendulum is kind of swinging back now after the last national election in terms of what's happening with my Republican colleagues and how they're having to find their place now with the new factions, I guess you could say, that exist, and finding some that are willing to move away from some of those hot button issues. Not totally, of course. And if we have votes on the floor, I think we'll still see probably what people would expect. I'm hoping that we're moving toward a time where there'll be more of a swing back to how can we work together. And that could mean perhaps that Democrats would have an opportunity to be a part of that discussion. I think Democrats need to build their bench. We still have an issue with not having as many people ready to take on some of the statewide offices. I think Democrats need to do more to hone their message. I think if you talk to anybody on the street and said, what is a Republican? They could answer your question right away with low taxes, limited government. You ask them what's a Democrat, and it's usually just the opposite as opposed to what Democrats actually stand for, which I like to say is healthy families, equal opportunity, and responsible government. Whatever the message, we need to have one.
What is the how to that part? You know, what does it look like to be able to do that? I mean, you know, you're active, I think, in kind of party event. You're out and about. You're in Austin. I mean, you know, what is the how of that?
Yeah, and that's what I'm talking about, the bench, I think, to some extent. How? There's another how here. Redistricting. As long as we have the lines drawn such that we cannot have competitive districts, I think it's more of a challenge than it needs to be. That's not the whole issue. I think we have issues, as I said, of Democrats trying to find the qualified people who are serving on the school boards, the city councils, the county commissioner courts, and bring them up. But at the same time, you know, when you have a handful of competitive districts and decisions are made in the primary and they're made by the base of the parties and you're basically a one-party state, de facto, there's the winner for November. And I think it makes it very hard to break through. I've been encouraged with what's going on in the courts. I hope we'll have some talk about redistricting. It doesn't appear that it might happen during this session, but it may have to happen in a special session. We've got to get to where we have better representation of the communities across the state, and then I think you'll see a change.
In the shorter term, less structural sense, we were talking before we came on about this kind of brewing race in the U.S. Senate primary. Mm-hmm. Beto O'Rourke is in. You know, it seems like Joaquin Castro is obviously thinking about it,
right,
you know, pretty seriously. Do you think that, I mean, I think you can cut that two different ways. Either we should spread the talent out or it's good to have some competitive races. You got thoughts on that?
I can see both of those approaches, actually. But I do think that it could be very rejuvenating to have a couple of strong Democratic candidates who are out there talking about the issues in a way that I think will get people's attention and hopefully get more energy into what's going on. And I think there's a concern that some people have that when you're in a primary that you end up injuring your opponent and then they come handicapped into the general. I think, though, most of us have looked at that as a way to make candidates stronger. And so I think it would be a good process, and I think it would be a great opportunity for Texas to finally see that we actually have some strong Democratic candidates.
I mean, that speaks to that's part of bench development, isn't it?
Right, exactly. Exactly.
I mean, it seems to me you look at Democratic races in the past, and we have a lot of people that run once and are out.
That's right. That's right. And, you know, there's a lot of new talent in the legislature. I'm actually one of the old people now there, chronologically and having served. So I'm hopeful about a lot of the people I see there and what they're doing. They're there for the right reasons. They're working on good, strong policy issues. They're representing their constituencies. I think we'll see some leadership coming out of some of those folks at the Capitol.
From the big issues then to one last, you know, very petty thing, have you made travel plans for June? You're on appropriations. You have not.
No, I have not.
Okay. You heard it here. Donna Howard, thanks very much for doing this.
Thank you. I enjoyed it. Thanks
much appreciated.
Sure thing.
That's it for us today. Thanks again to Representative Howard. Keep an eye out for video of this interview and more resources on Texas politics at the Texas Politics Project website. And have a good week.